welcome to How I Got Here, the inside stories of startups and innovation in travel and transportation with your hosts, PhocusWire's Kevin May and Mozio's David Litwak.
Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, wherever you are. Thank you, and welcome to another episode of How I Got Here. This is Mozio and PhocusWire's weekly podcast looking at innovation and the stories around startups in travel and transportation. We're delighted this week to welcome Travis Pittman. He's the CEO and co-founder at TourRadar. TourRadar, for those that don't know, is a both a consumer-facing and a supplier-facing on the tech side business in the multi-day tours and activities sector. For those of you that have had your head buried in the sand probably for the last couple of years will know that, and the likes of us have talked this up a lot, but tours and activities is, in inverted commas, the hot sector. So, you know, it's timely, therefore, that we get Travis in. Based in Vienna, Austria, but it also has offices in Toronto in Canada and Brisbane in Australia. Travis is, as you may well realise, as soon as he starts talking, is a native Australian. So, Travis, welcome to How I Got Here.
Thanks a lot. Yeah, great to be here. Thanks, guys.
Okay, so we always start off the podcast with the question. Tell us briefly how you got here, Travis.
Absolutely. Yeah. So you already stole my thunder. I'm an Aussie. About 14, 15 years ago, my brother and co-founder of TourRadar, Sean, was living in London. And he said, hey, it's great. Come over here. It's good money. You can travel lots. And so took the chance, went over to London on a 4-year working holiday visa. And I'm now 15 years into that. So it's been a bit longer than expected. But yeah, no, moved to London and yeah, I was always fascinated by the internet, so was really involved and learned to code and do HTML and everything like that. But as an Aussie living in London, the travel aspect was obviously a huge thing. So everyone was taking weekends and getting away and taking longer trips to Europe and Africa and Asia. And as part of that, we actually created was kind of our first entrepreneurial effort, Sean and I. We created a website called Bug Bitten, so to be bitten by the travel bug. And it was a photo sharing site. So it was a place kind of like Facebook, but, you know, before Facebook existed. And we were the default platform for all the Aussies, Kiwis, South Africans living in London to share their photos and their travel blogs online with friends and family. So it was kind of our foray into it. No one understood what the hell social media was back then or user-generated content. So we were kind of pioneering something that no one knew anything about. And eventually, cut a long story short, Sean being the finance guy that he is, so he was working in venture capital, he was like, well, we need a business model. We can't just build something and have, you know, tons of users and lots of people using it. We need to actually make some money. So we actually then realized that maybe this multi-day tour space that we were doing tours ourselves and booking it through offline travel agents, and a lot of our friends were as well, maybe that was something to actually digitize and bring online. So it was around the time 2005, 2006 when Booking, Expedia, Skyscanner were all digitizing various parts of the travel industry. And so we, you know, very naively gave it a crack and thought that we could do it pretty quickly. And obviously, that's about, you know, 14 years later, we are where we are today. But yeah, it's been a pretty long journey, lots of ups and downs. But yeah, now after raising around $65 million in around 6 or 7 different rounds, we have a team of 275 people globally, as you mentioned, in Brisbane, Toronto, and Vienna as the headquarters, and soon to be opening up an office in New York as well. So yeah, it's been a hell of a ride and happy to share some of my experiences today.
That's great. Thanks for the brevity there, Travis. I mean, there's so many elements that we can dive into with the story behind, I guess, yourself and your brother and TourRadar. I mean, something I remember Bug Bitten
as being. Oh, do you? Okay.
Yes, I remember that. So from my very, very early days when I joined Travolution in 2005, it was one that was kind of banded around a little bit as one of these kind of user-generated content-led sites. I mean, was it a necessity that you kind of needed to transition from that, which I presume probably didn't make a lot of money, to something where you could envisage there would be a lot more money on the table?
Yeah, definitely. So I think, yes, it took a lot of time, but there was so many lessons learned and basically pivots and different things we had to try. Like in terms of business models, we started out, I believe it was like a subscription model where you paid 10 euros a year or 10 pounds a year or something like that. And then that didn't really work. And then we had this membership program. So we had all these different types of models. Each learning from one of those basically took us a step further. And then it pretty much got to the point where it was like, well, who's going to pay for something like this? And it pretty much got to a point where we said, well, the tour operators are the ones who want business. They actually want to have more bookings and more, you know, travelers actually on their tours with them. And the whole model of paying commission for leads or actually getting bookings was obviously something that we thought, well, it's more chance of getting money out of them than actually out of a traveler paying some sort of service or fee where everything kind of is expected to be free in terms of the internet. So that was kind of led us down the path of eventually going to the transactional model and going to bookings.
And just, I mean, just on the last one from me for a while, I mean, I'm interested in when people, you know, write or design a business model. I mean, did you sketch out TourRadar's business model in a lot of detail, or was it in some, often they could be written on the back of a cigarette packet, but I'm sure you didn't get like that. But I mean, how detailed was your business model? Was it just, as you said just then, Travis, you know, we needed to make money from that element and kind of move from something else?
Yeah, it at first it was basically just scrambled to get something consumers adopted, and the photo side really worked well. I mean, we had in 2004 20,000 photos a day being uploaded to something, you know, back then. Oh, wow. Digital cameras weren't even really being used back then. You still had to put a CD-ROM in and actually get the digital photos off the film camera. And so we were, you know, super successful in that regard. But it was obviously no one knew anything about online and payments and all that kind of stuff. So it was really just trial by learning, really. And we pretty much just, step by step, and tried something, it didn't work, and then tried something else. But as the story got a bit more concrete to where we were going, so once we got to the, the stage where we said, okay, we need to go to transactional and bookings, for sure, that's when we started to map out and actually, you know, what's our vision and what do we want to actually achieve with this, and who are we actually providing value to? I wouldn't say it was a full-fledged, like 40, 50-page document or anything like that, but for sure, as you started to flesh out the initial pitch decks to go to investors with, that's where you started to actually get some Excel spreadsheets and start to model things out and work out where you might be able to make some money and then put those into the pitch deck that you were going to be sending out.
Hey, Kevin, David here. So I feel like the tour operator sector is very traditional. I've been in the industry for 8 years, and I still feel like I discover random regional or even massive tour operators that I haven't heard of, every week. I think that's a test of the fact that many times they operate behind the scenes, they operate without technology or very limited technology. So I'd love if you delved a little bit more into how you brought these guys online and how big of a hurdle was that.
Yeah, and I think, as I say, with most successes or entrepreneurial successes, it's about timing. And I feel that we, as the multi-day tour space, we are probably around 10 years behind the hotel industry, if not more. And that was really a challenge in the early days. Like in 2005, 2006, there was just no way to get availability or pricing or inventory from the tour operators. So, it was, I think, 2007, I started to talk to them about XML feeds and actually saying, hey, you've got, I don't know if you guys know the history of XML, but with these big operators, they created the XML feeds to be able to send their, create brochures and print brochures on the other side of the world. So they'd actually send a file, which would go to the printer, which was XML, and then they'd basically reproduce that into the printed brochures. And so we basically were just taking those XML feeds and then trying to consume that and do something with it. And so on top of that, we then started to educate them about APIs And it was around that time, a bit further on, was when like the first reservation platforms like Tour CMS started to pop up and actually started to provide this service for the operators to use and not have to build it themselves or anything like that. So yeah, super challenging and very much trying to educate people who are very passionate about what they do and very good at what they do, like in terms of operating tours. They just have, you know, rightfully so, no idea about the technology and what you need to be able to distribute online. So it was a lot of education around that. And so that's where we found ourselves very often, and even still today, the big companies like Intrepid and G-Adventures and Contiki, we're pretty much the guinea pig for all of them whenever they wanted to do an API or whenever they've got upgrades to the API. They always generally come to us and say, look, you know, we're doing this. And sometimes we've had their tech teams actually fly into our office and actually sit down and work with our teams to get things up. So yeah, there's been a lot of education process over time.
It's interesting though, Travis. I mean, this is 2019. this podcast will be
yes.
Yeah, but I mean, the point I'm making is that, do you sense that, you know, your industry and where you operate within it probably should have kind of moved on a little bit by 2019? Or is it because, you know, I'm quoting every other person that's in the there's no activities industry, that it is still a bit of a wild west in terms of the way everything kind of operates? Were you expecting still to be at this stage where there's educating, in your words, still to be done?
Yes and no. So on one hand, I understand it purely for the fact that around 90% of multi-day tours are still booked offline, so through offline travel agents. So there's not there's a lot of business being generated from offline agents still. So, you know, it hasn't been that there's just been a massive decline, and so they've had to jump across to actually start to use online or other distribution channels. So I can understand that side, but also at the same time, it is a little bit frustrating at times when you're basically starting from scratch and just educating operators on, okay, this is how online distribution works. But everyone has to learn from somewhere. And I think it's only through that webinars maybe like this and obviously travel shows and conferences where they can learn, do they actually learn from their peers as well? Like, oh, you're using this, are you? Okay, maybe I should be doing that as well. Which is where we get a lot of our leads from operators wanting to join the platform, because they hear that their, you know, competitors or friends are using us or you know, similar platforms, and then that's how they, you know, learn and actually want to get educated on it.
Got it. So you said something interesting there about how you said 90% of tours are actually booked through offline, often agents. It reminds me of a stat I heard about cruises, how it's something like 60-65% of cruises are also booked manually offline by travel agents. And I've seen a ton of attempts at trying to bring cruise booking online. And obviously you can book a cruise online, but there's something to be said for, you know, something like that high touch. People want to speak to someone. And I think there's been, you know, we all come from the travel tech world. The death of the travel agent has been highly exaggerated. And I guess it would be wonderful to hear about a little bit how you think about how to operate and build tech in an industry that is inherently doesn't need tech as much, or at least needs much more high touch service in addition to tech. And how do you become complementary instead of trying to just replace?
Yeah, I think that's been, I would say, one of the keys to our success in the early days was that we didn't necessarily go to the tour operators and say, hey, we have this platform, you need to provide us with XML or an API in this particular format so that we can, you know, connect to it and it's minimal work for us. And we pretty much were just like, well, give us what you've got and we'll try and map it as well as we can to our system. And then over time, we kind of educate them, well, if you can add these fields or if you can add this functionality, that would help. So it's about being flexible and adaptable. And I think some of the maybe the bigger incumbents in the early days probably just didn't have that flexibility or weren't willing to make those sacrifices.
If I can quickly interrupt, I guess kind of what I was getting at is like, were you building more for those? Did you build any tools for those travel agents who were doing 90% of the selling? Did you target part of your site to them? Or was it completely targeted consumer? Or
Good question. Yeah, so no, we didn't try and go for the travel agent side. We've pretty much for the last 4 or 5 years been focused on B2C, so direct to consumer. In saying that, I do see one day there is a need for a GDS or a global distribution system for the multi-day product. And with the live inventory that we have and access to all the APIs, there is an opportunity there. It's just it's obviously a pretty big challenge to roll that out, something like that is flexible enough for innovative offline travel agents and for some of the older school ones to still work with as well.
Something on that. I mean, I know we're really getting into the weeds of this, but I mean, it's really interesting, and I think so much of it is relevant to other sectors that happened, as you said, 10 years ago. When you say a GDS for the tourism activities industry, that would essentially be reliant on things such as standards, and there are no standards that I'm aware of a substantial nature that are industry-wide in tourism activities at the moment. Is that correct?
That's correct, yeah.
Right, so if the GDS for the tourism activities vision is to come to pass, how would that be done? Who would be in charge of it? And is it something that is achievable, do you think?
Yeah, I think there would need to be some, if you're talking about a GDS for the entire tours and activity space, because I think the phrase of tours and activities is obviously a very, very generalized one as well, because we get thrown inside that, but obviously we're very different to the likes of the attractions and in-destination activities. So to cater to everything, yeah, I probably would agree there needs to be some kind of standards there, but I do feel as well, I think if there's going to be someone, it'll more than likely just be someone who makes a run at it and does it the best that they can. And then if it works and there is traction, then other people will have to adapt to that, is my feeling. But, maybe there is some sort of harmony sort of situation that gets done where everyone comes together and agrees on standards. But I know it's been tried a couple of times. Open Travel was one of them.
Yes.
It didn't really fly because everyone was just trying to work stuff out in those early days as well.
Okay, and that's interesting. I mean, I was going to ask you, because you referenced him at the beginning, just a little bit about the company before we can come back to bits about the industry that you operate in. But your brother's the CFO.
Yes.
So, a first question, just out of curiosity, is he older than you? And I mean, how does it work as a dynamic? As you are brothers, but you're business partners, but you're also his boss. So, I mean, you're the first person that we've had on How I Got Here that's had this kind of familial relationship as a co-founder and even within the business. So just give us an idea of how that all kind of works.
Yeah, sure. So no, he's older. So he's 6 years older. And for sure, at times it does feel a little bit strange. Okay, yes, I am his boss, technically. But because we've been working together literally for around 15 years now, we know each other extremely well, and we know which buttons to push and not which ones not to push. And we've certainly had our moments over the years where, we haven't spoken to each other for, a couple of days or maybe a week or so, because, we really don't agree on some things. I think we've seen so many different ups and downs that we know that whatever it is, we'll work it out somehow. And also being related with blood, it's sort of something that you never want to jeopardize ever. It's basically, the time I still remember when I actually, I was going out pitching actually to, I think, one of the first investors that we were trying to get on in like 2012. And it was like, well, it just seemed weird because we didn't really have official titles. And I was like, well, I'm the one sort of going out pitching. Do you mind if I'm the CEO and kind of the face? He's like, yeah, that's okay. No worries. So that was basically the conversation. There was no kind of big discussion or anything like that. So it was quite easy in those days, and it's kind of kept that way. We see each other about 2-3 times a year. I go back and forth. He's in Brisbane. I'm here. We do our leadership team offsites twice a year, and I go to Australia once or twice as well. So we do see each other, but we speak, pretty commonly, a couple of times a week still today.
Just a last one from me on this, because I'm curious, and maybe because I don't have a brother that I'm in business with. But I mean, how do you resolve disagreements?
Like I said, some time sometimes to let the steam get off and then actually think it over and try and actually see each side of it. And then the best way I do find is to actually have like a video call because I think when it's on a phone call or when you're just chatting like over say Slack or Skype or something like that, you can interpret words wrongly and maybe they're written in haste and not really in the way that they should be. So yeah, so I find like a video call is the best way actually to resolve things.
Yeah, I've seen the way my daughter with social media resolves arguments and in text form it doesn't work at all.
No. So, no worries.
Yeah. So I wanted to rewind a little bit and at the risk of sounding obsessed with one thing you said around the 90% of tours are offline, I kind of wanted to delve into, you know, why you said you guys have been a consumer site mainly for the last 4 to 5 years. I wanted to understand why, because I think what's really interesting for a lot of our listeners is why did our, you know, the founders make decisions they made on the pathways to their success? Obviously, you chose to focus on 10% of the market, and that's not a super intuitive, you know, decision, but obviously it's working for you. So I'd love if you delve a little more into that.
Yeah, so in the early days of like transitioning from Bugbitten to then creating TourRadar, we saw quite a lot of success out of the like meta search type model. So we were actually creating iframes and working with publishers. So like Lonely Planet and back in the day it was Let's Go Travel Guides and quite a few others where we put like an iframe on their site and then we shared the revenue in terms of clicks. And so that worked really well. The problem was there was just no way to work out attribution. So the tour operators had no idea was the click valuable or not. And it was extremely hard to basically work out. And so we then, as we created TourRadar and we started to build out the model a bit more, we went to partners and we thought, if we can work with some of the big OTAs and provide a tours tab and things like that. Yes, in theory, it all sounds nice, but at the end of the day, a multi-day tour, which is typically around 12 to 14 days long, is kind of the wrong way around booking things. So that works in terms of how an OTA typically works, where you book the flight, then you book the hotel, then you book the car hire and everything else around it. Where with a multi-day trip, think of Tanzania and Kilimanjaro, you're not going to book a flight and then book your Kilimanjaro trek. You want to make sure that trek is available, that's the one you want. And once you've booked that, you then book the flight. So afterwards. So it never fitted into the customer journey that really is how the OTAs work. We tried and we really pitched it and we gave it our all and just didn't see any success. And we always were at the mercy of these big companies or even smaller ones to integrate. And you know that priorities change within every company. And the first thing to go will be some sort of speculative offering like the one that we were offering. And so you typically got, after 3 or 4 months of trying to integrate, they just send an email and say, look, sorry, priorities have changed. We can't do this anymore. And so you weren't in charge of your own destiny. And then that's when we decided, okay, let's take control of that destiny and go to the B2C route, where we were very good at SEO obviously working out how can we then grow out the business through other channels like email and paid search and everything like that as well.
So why not focus? Well, so maybe this is a distinction that I'm missing here. With B2C, do you mean direct travel agents too and just not through Expedia? Or is it... Or do you mean direct to the literally?
Sorry, track? Direct to consumer. So you as a consumer booking it with the tour operator. No.
So then, yeah, I guess the question is why not focus on those travel agents that do 90% of the bookings? Or when you say 90% of the bookings, I guess I'm wondering if do you mean online travel agents, physical, in-person, you know, travel agents, traditional travel agents? Assuming you mean traditional travel agents, have you focused at all on them? I guess that's, yeah.
Yeah, and it is, and we definitely had conversations with them. But by the agents, I mean are traditional. Like if you think of Flight Centre, if you think of STA Travel, Trail Finders, those type of guys, even the home-based travel networks that are in the US. And we tried to partner with some of them, and the problem was it just every single agency network or franchise or whatever it was had different expectations and different things that they wanted, and they either wanted to be customized, they either wanted to be all branded their own, and it really wasn't an easy solution to go down. And so again, we felt we were kind of being more of a software developer and having to customize every single integration rather than actually just building one platform that we then push out to a global audience and then build and make better and better just through, you know, learning from what our customers want and like, and then actually making everything a better user experience for them.
If I could venture a guess, it sounds like your product was unique enough. There weren't enough people doing it, and the margins were potentially high enough. As you're talking about, you know, tours for 14 days, it could be $5,000 to $10,000 or something that you could actually get away with the direct to consumer. I think can tell me if I'm wrong here, but I think a theme of this podcast so far is when we find a direct to consumer company that's been able to make it work and play the game of paying for AdWords versus booking in Expedia, they found kind of a hack. And is that, you know, is the hack that simple? Is it that you've got a really high ticket product that is rare, and so you're able to make a B2C business work?
Yeah, I believe so. Yeah, it's definitely one of the aspects, and it's also understanding the consumer journey, and I think that's the key difference, is that a customer going to book like a weekend in Paris, where they book a flight, an activity and hotel and everything, is a very different customer who is booking a 14 day, you know, Inca Trail trek from Australia, where they're booking it 6 to 9 months out. So the user journey is completely different, and that also then the keyword set and the types of people you're targeting is very different, and that's where things like email comes into play, because you've got a detailed customer journey that's got to be played out over a long period of time. It's not just a click and book in the same session. You've got to kind of warm them up as well and get them across the line.
It's interesting, Travis, on that. I mean, you said you've always been very strong in the area of SEO and, you know, the consumer focused strategy. How would you describe that has changed over time? By which I mean, you know, we've had the emergence of other players, and indeed the search engine that we're talking about is kind of dipping its toes in the broader tours and activities sector, not least mostly on attractions and things like that. But how has the SEO game, I suppose, is the question I'm looking for, how has that changed over time, would you say?
Yeah, it's definitely evolved. I mean, we've managed to stay fairly well on top of it by having a, you know, pretty big focus on it over the years. But the huge shift, obviously, which is not any surprise, is the mobile side of things, and just the screen space pretty much being filled up by ads rather than actually the organic results. And that definitely has an effect on things for sure. And I mean, the challenge for a high basket size product like ours, where it isn't a search and then click and then book, is how do you get someone from like a really broad search term, like maybe like Europe travel or something like that, to then getting down the line and actually booking a $5,000 experience. It's like, it's obviously no mean feat. And I think that takes a lot of data and a lot of knowledge about the customer to be able to do that, and to be able to then make the search side work.
And let's talk a little bit about, you've raised, I would say, in the grand scheme of the things of the broader tourism activity sector, a fair amount of money. So talk to us, Travis, a little bit about how you've approached fundraising, you know, in the context of being B2C, and how you've kind of broadly pitched the idea to your investors.
Yeah, it's been a definitely at each stage, quite a different experience. So in the very early days, so back in like 2012, when we started to raise our first round, because so before that, Sean and I were basically sort of self-funding it and bootstrapping it, and then realized that we need money to make money, and we needed people to help us. So when we started to go out, it was obviously tours and activities, and specifically multi-day tours, as most people, there's a negative, you know, stigma and perception of them. It's basically that you're following an umbrella around a city and you're being herded around and there's no flexibility and all the people who are on the tour are not good people and you're not going to like them. So there's a lot of negativity around it. And so there's that perception when we were talking to investors was, well, this is a dying market. Who does these things anymore? And so it took quite a while and a lot of persistence before. And I feel that it was the likes of Get Your Guide and Viator and those guys in the early days who started to put this spotlight a bit more on the, you know, activities sort of side of things and experiences side of things. And so now it seems logical that, oh, this is a hot space and this is a sexy space and everything like that. But for the, you know, the first 5 or 6 years, it just hasn't been that case. So pitching it to investors was very difficult to kind of break that perception. And it wasn't until we had that, you know, traction in terms of bookings and customers and real revenue that made it obviously a lot easier to start to raise money and obviously start to prove out that this was a viable thing that could be built and that there was still a gap in the travel industry that no one felt was possible these days because of the big players out there.
So you said something really interesting there about, you know, a lot of investors thought it was a dying industry. And number one, I think it's a relevant point for our listeners to make is in that I'm surprised at the number of startups that have built, you know, they built really, really big companies off of stuff that if you read TechCrunch, you'd think it was a dying industry. But if you pay more close attention to the industry, you realize it's actually, you know, growing or thriving or, you know, needs a huge upgrade. But what it reminded me of is actually we had a conversation with Paulina at Wanderoo, and she was talking about how the bus rider had become more and more millennial, you know, 10 plus years ago, and I was redefining what it meant to ride a bus with the emergence of megabus, etc. And I do think kind of what you said about it being a dying industry, there is some truth to that, and that I don't know many friends who would opt into a Contiki tour. I do see there are kind of modern new equivalents kind of coming onto the market, and the one I can kind of think of actually is Yacht Week, and there's new ways of people on a gathering on a tour basis that is engaging at the more millennial generation. So I, you know, how do you think about not just your tech company, but I'd say the wider tours industry evolving from the Contiki or old people being escorted on and off in a bus kind of stereotype, and how is that being redefined?
Yeah, I think a lot's being done, but also those particular operators you mentioned, they're also redefining themselves because they obviously know the customer is changing and what they want is changing. So I think if you look at a Contiki tour today as opposed to what it was maybe 10 years ago, it's an extremely different experience. And you know they are catering to a lot of the things that the consumer is wanting. So I think, and that's the generally across the industry, is that tour operators have to stay with the times if they want to survive. And you do see they, you know, having smaller groups, or they're making more local experiences or local guides, that sort of thing. So they do have their finger on the pulse and they are changing. But for sure, one trend that we are seeing is just the smaller group size. You get down to 12, 15 people. That's kind of a size that's getting, you know, pretty popular rather than the 50 people on the bus. And even those 50 people on the bus, they're maybe reducing the number of people down to 40 instead of 50, so it's not as crammed and you got a bit of space as well. So there's a lot of reinvention happening within older operators who have been out there for a longer time, but the new ones, yeah, like Yacht Week and there's a bunch of others in Thailand and through Asia who are creating these experiences where you're traveling in a group, but it feels like you're actually traveling, but you actually feel as though it's an independent experience. And trying to find that balance where people have flexibility and time to do things on their own and not feel chained to the group, and know that the people who are booking onto that trip are like-minded, and that they actually will like or really hang out and get along with a fair chunk of people who are on that trip.
That last part actually, so it's funny you said two things that I think are, you said one, freedom for them to do what they want, and then two, they'll actually be like-minded. And actually that was about what I was about to ask, which is, it seems like, you know, Yacht Week attracts a lot of people and gets them excited because they think, oh, well, there's a bunch of people exactly like me that are going to be on this. It'll be a social experience. And it's like a little frat party for a week. So, I mean, that's that demographic, but it seems like community is also a huge thing that some of these guys are emphasizing. Would you say that's accurate?
Massively, yeah. I think that's what people don't realize, is that you typically will make one or two lifelong friends on that on a trip, like a tour you do. So again, you're not going to like love the whole group and stay in touch with everyone, but most people will stay in touch, and then they'll travel and do other tours with them in the future. And so that community aspect is a huge aspect that people don't really fully understand yet, and I think that's a huge opportunity to try and for us to educate the market and elevate the category, so to speak. The other way I like to put it is, if you're going to climb Kilimanjaro, you basically, the itinerary is going to filter out people who don't want to do that trip. So the people who will do that trip have looked at the itinerary, they've understood what it's about, and if they've booked it, there's a pretty good chance that they're going to have some similar interest to you. And that goes for, you know, obviously many itineraries around the world. So that's something that a lot of people don't really realize as well.
I love that. I actually saw Cadbury chocolate. their wrappers have their logo, obviously, and then a pouring milk kind of icon. And there's actually recently they had a campaign where it was just the pouring milk icon, and it was just... It was literally some text on the bottom left, and it said that this bear wrapper is because 225,000 seniors do not speak to anyone for an entire weekend, and it's all talking about loneliness, et cetera. And I think there's a lot of kind of PR in the travel industry around, like, you know, bringing the world together, blah, blah, blah. And I think a lot of it kind of is PR, but it's because, like you said, many of us just book flights and hotels and that don't speak to anyone. But it's interesting to hear kind of, you know, maybe your company really will solve human loneliness, Travis.
Yeah, possibly. But it's actually a point. Like, I went to a hostel fairly recently, and a friend used to work in a hostel bar, and it used to be such a social experience, everyone going to the bar and meeting and chatting. And I walked in fairly recently, everyone's on their phones. They're all sitting there separately, basically chatting. So this whole idea of you go to a hostel and then you meet all these new friends, which is the whole independent, you know, backpacker style of doing things, is very different today than it was, say, 10 to 15 years ago because of devices. And I think that's the benefit of a group, is that you meet each other, you have to break the ice, you get to know each other, and then you start to work out who do you like and who do you maybe, you know, don't need to spend time with. So it definitely is a way to bring people together.
I definitely have a lot of friends at hostels myself, and it's a shame. I don't know if it's just because I'm 31 now and people don't talk to me. I think a few times I stay at them, but I also feel like they're not at a social either. But sorry, Kevin, go on.
Yeah, you should be 46, David, and then it gets really bad, I can assure you. And as someone who interrailed three times throughout Europe in the 1990s, I know exactly what you're coming from in terms of that, you know, the hostel or hostel, as you would say, being the community aspect. And so I kind of wanted to move on a little bit, Travis. I mean, I think, you know, we talked about the hot sector in inverted commas at the beginning in the introduction, you know, and we've seen, we kind of referenced a little while ago, you know, what Google is doing at the broader kind of attractions level. But, you know, it would be safe to say that the kind of the mega OTAs have really started to kind of think about your sector or the sector broadly. What do you say when you see something like, when you see a brand like booking.com kind of wading in? And again, they are doing the attractions element at this stage, but, you know, it's not a huge leap for them to start doing tours and indeed multi-day tours at some point. So what does that mean for you as the CEO of a company if people in the team are indeed perhaps nervous then? Well, how do you, it's a two-part question. I mean, one is, what is your opinion on them kind of entering the sector? And two, how do you kind of, as the CEO, as I said, kind of reassure the team that you're, you know, you're on the right path and they shouldn't worry?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's an inevitable. I feel we've been pretty, if you want to call it lucky, we've been playing in a space on our own for a fairly long time.
Yeah.
And it was bound to happen at some stage. So I think it's validation that this is a space. And back to sort of 6-7 years ago, the investors saying this is, you know, a dying market is obviously being proven wrong now by seeing the interest in this space. We typically don't like to get too hung up by competitors. Like, so I think if you're looking sideways and backwards too much, you obviously lose sight of where you want to go and yeah, what your vision is. And so I've never really kind of looked, and maybe it's because we've never had a true massive competitor come in, but and of course we keep our eye on things. We definitely, and the team, as you say, they do read you know, PhocusWire, and they do read all the other kind of publications that mention the travel industry and tours, what's happening. So I actually welcome it in one way, because I also think this isn't a you know, winner take all. There's no way that one player can completely own this entire market globally. So I feel that you know, there might be someone who comes in and does something quite well, and maybe we are better at something else. So I think we have to just wait and see and see who does come into it. How well do they actually adapt and you know, come into the space? But for sure, we've kind of paved a bit of a way and shown that it can be done. And that's obviously a bit of a worry, you know, first mover. But we feel that if we can keep sort of moving proving that this can be grown, and we start to grow the market, just because right now we're just in the English-speaking markets, and obviously over time we want to start going into other markets. So trying to continue to grow and make this a true global platform, that obviously we just keep focused on that, we'll see what happens over time.
Just on that though, I mean, you've done a strategy that's based, I would imagine, on, as you said, SEO, but I would imagine done fairly cheaply, as it were, in that you're not spending a lot of money on digital marketing, whereas some of your potential competitors, if we can call that, have been known to spend $6 billion a year on marketing, not on tours and activities. That would be quite extraordinary, but yep, especially on things like hotels. I mean, that could fundamentally alter your entire strategy, couldn't it, if they have the ability to, you know, frankly outspend you.
Absolutely, yeah, and I think that all comes down to how quickly do the players roll stuff out, and I do see it as with any business, things are about focus, and I feel there's a lot of competition happening in certain areas like hotels, and I mean, obviously with all the stuff happening with booking right now, they've got a lot of things they're trying to sort out. So going into all these other verticals or other things is a challenge, like, you know, to do them well. Like, you can do them, and yes, they have the size, but to really go deep requires focus. And is there belief that this is truly a big enough thing to move the needle for them? It's yet to be decided, really. And so, yeah, I mean, I think it's going to take a good 18 months to 2 years for the bigger players to really start to have any inroads into this space, if they do. And I mean, I think you also have to look at like Airbnb with what they did with the experiences. Did that fundamentally affect Get Your Guide or Klook? I don't think so, you know, and they've pushed that a lot, and probably it's doing well, but I don't know if it really hurt those other two players, you know, and stopped them from raising huge amounts of capital and continue to grow pretty crazily.
Okay, so one final one from me, and then I think we're going to wrap up. When we were in our virtual green room, if I can call it that, Travis, before we went on there, you used a great phrase, and that was war stories. Think of any war stories or incidents over those over decade plus now that are, you know, useful for our startup listeners, and how you've kind of overcome something that was really problematic.
Yeah, I think the one of the war stories was that decision to go from B2B to B2C, actually, so that which we talked about. And we, the very first leadership team offsite we did, I think was in 2015, where this was the outcome that we came out from. And we, you know, 'cause we were trying for years and years to make this work. And I think it was just we tried everything. And then it was like, okay, no, what's the way we can take control and have the destiny in our hands, as I mentioned before. And that was a pretty big decision at that time to make and say, okay, no, we're going to forget all this other opportunity. Like David sort of said, that 90%, or, you know, more of the market, we're going to say, no, we're not going to go for that. We're going to go and try to bring this market online and focus on the consumer. That was a very, you know, not tough call, but it was just one that took a lot of pain to get to, because there was a lot of going to PhocusWire and meeting a lot of different players, and then realizing that okay, this isn't the future of where we should go for the company.
Okay, on behalf of our sister company, we always liked your continual attendance at our.
No worries. You're welcome,
David.
Yeah, well, I think that's all from us. You know, thanks, Travis. That was wonderful. You know, just wrapping up, this has been another How I Got Here, Stories of Innovation in Travel and Transportation. We're releasing these weekly. You can access them on PhocusWire.com and Mozio.com/move. And thanks again, Travis.
Thanks so much. It was great.
Thanks for listening to How I Got Here podcast. We'll be back next week with more inside stories behind startups and innovation in travel and transportation. Check mozio.com/move for a complete write-up of the highlights of every podcast with translations into 5 languages. And get your daily dose of news on the digital travel economy by subscribing to the newsletter at PhocusWire.com. See you next week.